Erev Tov, good evening everyone.
Good evening.
I'm starting a series now, which will take between 3 to 6 sessions, depend how fast we will finish it. And this is perhaps, the most important subject for people who wants to be righteous that they have to know very well. That's why, in my opinion, you don't want to miss even 1 week. But this is a series that I'm starting today. It's everything I'm going to say is from the Rambam. Don't ever dare to think, that the Rambam wrote it based on his opinion, or he made it up, or this is his understanding, God forbid. Everything is almost word by word from the Gemara, mostly from Masechet Sanhedrin. Masechet Sanhedrin is a part of the Oral Torah that speaks about, oh, Masechet Sanhedrin is a part that speaks about the 4 method of executions. 4 different kinds of execution that the Torah said to execute the wicked people. And Masechet Sanhedrin cover all the scenarios for what sins, witnesses, no, yes, and don't. Also, it speaks about tshuva, the way to make tshuva, and many other important things. So it's word, literally word by word from the word of Chazal, from the Gemara. Where did it come to the Gemara? All these Mishnayot in Sanhedrin, every Jew has a share to the world to come, etc., etc., but it's subject to some conditions, and you know, where does it come from? This is everything what God gave Moshe Rabbeinu in Har Sinai. When he gave him the Torah, yesterday, when I was here, I spoke in Hebrew about Parashat Yitro, the acceptance of the Torah. It will be on the website in 3-4 days from now, Bezrat Hashem. I gave that in already. Speaking about what the Jews receive in Mount Sinai, and from that moment on, you know, from that moment on, the rest is basically history. So I would like to start with the laws of tshuva, Ilchot Tshuva, according to the Rambam. Remember, if you have questions, try to keep it to the end of the shiur. Like this, we don't have to waste time and get out of the subject. Every mitzvah in the Torah, the Rambam says, whether it's a positive mitzvah or a negative, which means restriction, what's the difference between mitzvat aseh to a mitzvat isur lo taseh? Now let's move on. Every positive mitzvah, it's an obligation from the Torah. A Jew has to give up to 20% of his total worth not to miss the mitzvah. Which means, I give you an example. If a Jew was arrested and a goy put him in a prison and he didn't give him a chance to take his tefillin with him. Now he's in prison. The morning arrived, now he has an obligation to put tefillin, right? At 5 o'clock, that's it, it's sunset, he would miss the mitzvah. Now it's 5 to 5, that's it. All day he's in jail, he didn't get out. They keep telling him another hour, waiting for an answer, the judge, the lawyer, stories. Now he has 5 more minutes. Now he said to the goy, do me a favor, my tefillin is in my car. Can you go get it to me? So the goy would laugh. I get you the tefillin, what, you crazy? He said, I'll give you $100, go give me the tefillin. If he agree, you got lucky. You didn't miss the mitzvah, because the reward for the tefillin is a trillion times more than important than $100, or even $100 million, yeah? The reward is endless, is eternal. For every mitzvah, once you go to Olam Haba, you continue to cash on that mitzvah forever and ever. So there's no common sense to miss even one mitzvah, yeah? What happened if that guy is clever? So $100? No. Hey, give me $5,000, then maybe I'll consider. And you have $5,000, but that's all the money you have. All your net worth is $5,000. You don't have to give it to him. You're not obligated. But what happened if you have $50,000, and he wants $5,000? That's only 10% of your total worth. You must give it to him. This is the test that God put you in. God put you in that test, and you must give it to him.
All the money?
No, up to 20% of your net worth. All the mitzvot of 20% of your total worth, you must give. More than that, you're not obligated. What happens if it's a restriction? A goy brings you chazir. Eat. Eat or I break your bones. Eat or I kill you. Oh, now here is the question. If you can bribe him not to give you this chazir, say, no, I don't want to eat chazir. And he say, you don't want, you have to pay me for that. How much you want, you say? He say, I want $100,000. Say, crazy, $100,000 just not to eat that? He say, yes, that's what I want. Now, if you have $1 million, if you're a wealthy guy, you have $1 million. If you have $1 million and he wants $100,000 not to feed you pork, you have to give it to him. You have to give your total worth, not to do one restriction from the Torah, not one violation from the Torah. If he comes and tell you, I want you to eat non-kosher, non-kosher chicken, non-kosher, whatever it is. If not, I take all your money. You have to let him take all your money and not agree to do it. So when it comes to restrictions, even if you're worth $100 billion, you have to give all your money not to violate even one of the 365 restrictions in the Torah. That's the law. That's the law. Everything. Every sin from the Torah. Every sin from the Torah.
Can I just write notes on my phone?
Yeah.
Questions I want
to ask. Can write notes, no problem.
Okay, thank you.
So, what I'm saying to you is, up to 100% of your worth, you have to give, not to miss, not to violate one restriction from the Torah. But when it comes to mitzvah taseh, for instance, to sit in a sukkah. You don't have sukkah, you're in Singapore right now. There's no sukkah to get. Somehow your plane landed emergency in Singapore 3 hours before Sukkot. And there's only one person that has sukkah. And he say, you want my sukkah, I'll give it to you, no problem. But I want $1 million for it. Well, he wants $1 million for it. Oh, if your total worth is more than $5 million, right? $1 million is less than 20% of your worth. You have to give it to him. But if you only worth $4 million, $1 million is already 25% of your total worth. You don't have to. Up to 20%, you have to. More than that, you dismiss. You got it? So far, you got that? This is the beginning of Ilchot Tshuva. If a person violates, whether a positive mitzvah or a restriction, whether he did it intentionally, soon we're going to see the difference, whether he did it not intentionally, when one day he decides to make tshuva, repentance, he wants not to be tzaddik, to be righteous, to return from his sin, he must make a vidui. First rule, that's what we do in a prayer every day, morning and evening. Every day, morning and evening. Every day, we do vidui in Shachrit and Mincha, and before we go to sleep, 3 times a day. Okay, so, why the Chachamim arrange that we will do every few hours vidui? Because the person doesn't know when he's going to die. Some people die in surprise, right? He thought he's going to work, boom, an explosion. How does he know? He didn't know an hour ago that it's his last hour of his life. Since we do not know what's going to happen, the fact that every few hours I make vidui, so it's recent. I didn't have that much time to make sins from my last vidui. So it's considered that I died out of tshuva. You understand? So it becomes a routine process every day. Shchatati, aviti, pashati. This is a confession of all the sins that an average person does.
And the holiday, we don't do vidui, so if somebody died and he didn't do vidui because of the holiday, what happens?
So he does. He say before the holiday start. In holiday, you don't say vidui because it's not... Because right now, it's a vidui, makes you depressed, make you think about your sin. Hashem wants you to be happy in a holiday. He doesn't want you to think, oh, I stole, oh, I murdered, I this, I violate Shabbat. Now how am I going to correct it? You're thinking about it, you get depressed. A normal person, when he thinks about his sins, he cannot be happy as he was before, right? A person is very happy, right? Let's see, smiling, laughing, drinking, enjoying. Then comes someone and say, you know what you did, you know, because of you, one boy got kicked out of the yeshiva. Soon as he hear that, if he continue to laugh, it doesn't bother him, then you know he's a rasha. Cannot be tzaddik, this guy. Soon as he heard it, because of me, wow, he left the yeshiva. Why? What happened? Why because of me? How can I correct it? Right away, you're not in the mood anymore for the party. Wedding, not wedding, it's sitting. Right? If a person prepared himself a very, very delicious steak, 3 hours, marinated it, put it, grill, went to buy special barbecue sauce, french fries, he fried. 3 hours he prepared the meal, then he got a phone call that his best friend just died. Can he touch the steak? Can he enjoy? Delicious. You just tell your best friend or your brother or your parents, chas v'shalom. A person heard such a thing, right away, dumped the steak to the garbage. He doesn't even remember about the steak. What's the difference? He realized there's no time to enjoy it right now. Everything in life has this right timing. It's not the time to deal with this now. So this is it. So you do vidui. How you make vidui, Rambam say, Ana Hashem, please God, Chatati. What's the difference between Chatati, Aviti, Pashati? There are three different ways to confess. One with the word Chatati. Chatati means I committed a sin. What does it mean, Aviti? I committed a sin. What does it mean, Pashati? I committed a sin. So why there are three different words? What's the difference? The first one, Chatati, means I committed a sin not intentionally. It wasn't my intention. Either I did not know it's a sin, or I did not know it's Shabbat today, or it happened out of my sleep, or anything like that. That I plan to do something good, or I didn't plan to do anything, and accidentally it became a sin. This is the sins right now, Chatati. Chet means not intentional. Aviti comes from the word Avon. Avon means intentional. Avon means intentional sin, which means he knows his chazir, delicious. Somebody tell him, yeah, you're a Jew, you're not allowed to eat this. Leave me alone, it's delicious. That's called Aviti. Knows he's doing the wrong thing, shaving with a razor, knowing it's not allowed, doesn't care. My face is like baby face. Yeah, over here it's baby face, over there it will be a different face when the time comes to pay for every shave. But, you know, you think you're wise, fine. You do what you want now, later you pay the price. What does it mean, Pashati? Pashati, what does it mean, Pashati? Pashati means not only I did it intentional, I did it intentional to get God angry on purpose. Not only, for instance, eating a steak of pork, it's intentional, but not to get God angry, to satisfy my desire. For instance, if it wouldn't be delicious, I wouldn't make the scene. Doing it to get God angry means I don't even like it. I only eat it to get the rabbi and Hashem angry. I rebel on purpose. I hate it. I hate the religion. I hate them telling me what to do. I do it just to get them angry. You have glad kosher steak and a steak from a cow, beef and beef. Glad kosher, not kosher. Nevela wasn't slaughtered according to the Torah. Same taste, cow and cow, beef and beef. Just he eats this. Why? To get angry. So we're not talking somebody that didn't want to walk 10 miles to get a kosher meal. We're talking somebody that it's in front of him, he does it on purpose. To get Hashem angry, that's called Pashati. Al menat le'achis. So far everything clear? Chatati, not intentional. Aviti, intentional. Pashati, not only intentional, intentional to get God and the rabbis and the authorities are all angry on purpose. Then the Rambam continue. The Rambam say, the more we do, you do, the more confessions you confess, the better it is. Hare ze meshubach. Why? Because God forgives a person more when he comes and when he comes to confess, he reveals his sins in front of Hashem. The more he does it, the better it is. In the time of Beit HaMikdash, when the Holy Temple was here, people had to bring sacrifices to Beit HaMikdash. As a part of the repentance, you bring a goat, a lamb, and the Kohen slaughter it, and then you do vidui, you do the confession while they slaughter, and you see all the blood on the altar. And that's the way people used to make tshuva. When do you have to bring a sacrifice? When? When it was a not intentional sin. When it was intentional sin, the punishment is much more serious. We're going to speak about it later. There are sins that makes a person guilty, and the punishments are execution by the Jewish court. Such as murder, is execution by sword. Such as eating chametz on Pesach, eating Yom Kippur, violating Shabbat. All the relation, forbidden relation sins. Sins with animal, man with man, all this restriction that the Torah spoke about, it's execution by the Jewish court. If two witnesses gave you a warning, and you got caught one more time repeating the same sin, or you continue while they were warning you after the warning, they report you to the Jewish court, and they send the police, and the police brings you to court, and they trial you, and if they found you guilty, you have execution. And the execution is in public. It's a very, very big embarrassment. But at least it helps the correction of the soul. Because the person, while he's doing it, his heart is broken. He asks forgiveness. They give him an opportunity, mitato kaparato, by killing him, it helps him to repent for the sin that he did. Then, some sins, it's between a man to another man. You broke your friend's arm. You hit him, now he needs a cast. So you have to pay him for the doctor, you have to pay him for the days that he's off work, you have to pay him for the embarrassment that he's an important lawyer and he has to walk like this with a cast everywhere he goes. The court evaluates the compensation and the penalty that you have to pay for the damage you made. You understand? So, because there are damages, financial damages, then it's a verdict by the court against one of the two, who's right, he has to pay to the other person. Also stealing. Stealing has to pay double if he got caught. If he made tshuva before he got caught, he returned exactly what he stole. Not more than that. Let's move on. In these days, when there is no Beit HaMikdash, there's no temple, we don't have the altar to repent for us, to erase our sins, all we have to do is tshuva, repentance. And this is what I would like to talk about in the next few sessions. The tshuva, making repentance, erase all the sins that a person did. Even was wicked most of his life. And before he died, he made tshuva. When I say tshuva, I mean to repent. Repentance. En mazkirim lo shum davar mirish'o. All the negative that he had in his file is automatically out of there. Erased. And the people around him, his friends, his teachers, whatever, neighbors, doesn't matter, have no permission to remind him how he used to be. Remember what a criminal used to be? Baruch Hashem, today you're righteous. Not allowed to remind him because it wasn't him. It's a new person already. That's it. He repented. His soul became clean.
That's full tshuva.
Full tshuva. We're going to explain what a tshuva is. We didn't get to it yet. Yeah.
Are you allowed to make tshuva on Judgment Day?
On?
Judgment Day?
You mean Judgment Day Rosh Hashanah or Yom Kippur? Which one of them? First of all, it's a little bit too late to make tshuva then, in Rosh Hashanah. If you begin to prepare your protection in court in the day of the trial, the situation is not exactly good. That's why Hashem gave you 30 days before Rosh Hashanah to do slichot, the months of Elul. Yom Kippur, it's really appealing. It's an appeal. The verdict was reached already on Rosh Hashanah. Yom Kippur gives you an opportunity to come and tell God, yeah, you judge me for such and such, I'm guilty, you cry, you ask for mercy, and Hashem cleans some of the punishments that He wanted to give you. And this is what's called Day of Repentance. You can do it in Yom Kippur, you cannot do it in other days of the year. Yom Kippur is a very strong day. Yeah.
So a person repents and Yom Kippur comes along and he's clean. So you want to tell me that he doesn't get any punishment for what was done?
No, all these questions that you have will slowly not be necessary, because we're going to cover everything. By the end of this series, you will have the merit to know 100% how to make tshuva and what not to do. How to do it in the most sufficient way. I promise you, if you listen to every word, you're going to see that everything will be very clear to you. Then, if most of his life he was wicked, and then he became righteous, right? And after Yom Kippur passed, and he cleansed the rest of the sins that were still pending, you're not allowed to remind him the things he used to do. Even though tshuva erased everything, and Yom HaKippurim erased the leftover, what wasn't erased yet, there are sins who can be erased momentarily. Which means, you decided today never to repeat that sin, or something that you are not doing. You say, okay, im neder, because you already promised in Har Sinai, from now on I'm beginning to do this mitzvah, I really regret that I didn't do it until today, I'm embarrassed, I'm ashamed, I'll ask Hashem to forgive me, soon Yom Kippur is going to come, doesn't matter, you don't need. Today you decide to make tshuva on that sin, right away it's forgiven. We're going to explain when. And there are sins who cannot be forgiven immediately. There are sins that will be forgiven later, after a certain period of time. We'll talk about that. For instance, the Rambam writes, if there is a mitzvah aseh she'en bakaret, a person has an obligation to do this mitzvah, for instance, to eat matzah on Pesach. To eat chametz is a karet, it's a restriction. We're not talking about restrictions right now. We're talking an obligation, a positive order that God gave you. What is it? Once a year in the night of Pesach, Leil HaSeder, there is a mitzvah to eat matzah. There's a mitzvah to eat matzah. A person didn't eat. I'm not in a mood. The night is over, the mitzvah is gone. What happened a year later? They tell him, you know, this year you have again this mitzvah to do matzah. Oh, he said, this year I'm going to do it. I regret that I didn't do it last year. Hashem forgive me. Chatati, aviti, pashati. He eats matzah today. It's forgiven. It's considered he makes tshuva on achilat matzah. Same thing, tefillin. A person has an obligation to put tefillin all his life, from day of bar mitzvah until the rest of his life. And one day he decides to start putting tefillin and he regrets that he did not do so until now. The moment he begins to do, immediately, right away, he corrects the sin. But, the Rambam writes in a beautiful language, "Eno zaz misham ad shemochalim lo." He doesn't move from his place until he's forgiven. It's an expression to say, right away, the sin is forgiven. Which you die, if you died a minute later, after you put tefillin and you regret that you didn't do until today, first time in your life you put tefillin, an hour later you died, forgiven. What about all the days you did not put tefillin? You lost the reward. What you lost, my friend. You didn't go to work, you didn't get paid. Now you show up for one day, we'll pay you and we forgive you that you didn't come. We don't punish you that you didn't come to work. We're not firing you, but we pay you only for today. Why? 6 days you didn't show up. You didn't show up, no money. We'll pay you for Friday. You came in the last day of the week. You're lucky, because you apologized and you came, you avoided your being fired. If you one more day wouldn't come, you'll be there, which means we fire you from this world, Hashem take you and throw you out of here. And then it's too late, you cannot correct. You understand? It's considered dying without tshuva. ובאלו נאמר שובו בנים שובבים. And this is what Hashem say, return my children, return from your sins. הרפא משובותיכם. If you return today, today I'm going to cure you from your sickness of not doing this mitzvah. Okay? אבל על מצוות לא תעשה. He violated the restrictions of the Torah. As we said before, violations of a restriction is much worse than not doing a positive mitzvah. You should not do is much more severe. And the punishments for that usually are much, much stronger. And the penalties for that is much, much, much stronger. And to do tshuva for those sins is much, much, much harder. And there is another level. There is restrictions that do not have karet. Karet means that Hashem wrote in the Torah for that specific sin that he cut the soul of that Jew from the next eternal life. Venichreta, nichreta in Hebrew means cut off a nefesh. I cut that soul out of my nation or out of my next world. Unfortunately, that's the truth. So that's why you're here, not to be in that statistic. Yeah.
The thing is,
in English, everything in English, no?
But so you're saying that person get cut off from Judaism and everything, right?
Yeah.
But we don't know that. So what happens if a woman gets married to a Jew? So technically that woman's not Jewish anymore. So does that mean the child's not Jewish?
No. I say got cut off. I didn't say got cut off Judaism. Because even though Hashem wrote in his file a cut that is cutting him for that sin that he made, the fact that he's still alive, he's still obligated to keep mitzvot, and everything can still be reversed. As I'm going to explain how to make tshuva for this kind of sins. As long as a person didn't die, that means Hashem did not materialize the punishment that is pending against him. If it would happen, that you know it's his end. But as long as he's alive, that means he still have a chance to correct everything, even murder, even Chilul Shabbat, which is worse than a murder, even that can be corrected. But once he died, then you know it's over. There's no way to correct because he's dead already. Dead people cannot make tshuva. It's too late. They missed the train. Now, a woman that married him, there's no connection as far as being Jewish or not. She is Jewish, she has her obligation, and he's Jewish, then he has to keep his obligation. However, when he dies, if she's righteous, she goes to heaven. If he's wicked, he goes to a much, much worse place. You understand? But it doesn't mean that while he was alive, he lost his Judaism. So what about this restriction that a person is doing, right? And we cannot erase it right away. You cannot erase it right away. Why? You need to wait until Yom Kippur will arrive. Once one Yom Kippur arrive and you fast and you tortured yourself, that Yom Kippur erased the pending sins that were still open. But there are some sins that even Yom Kippur does not erase. It helps, but it doesn't erase. All the sins that the Torah say, ונכרתה הנפש האם ישראל, sins that has karet in it, Yom Kippur does not fully erase those sins. When those sins are being erased, after a grace period of time of suffering. If a person did not receive suffering, it's not a good sign. It's a sign that God does not accept his tshuva. If he would accept his tshuva, he begin to hit him left and right. And that's a very good sign. So all these people, excuse my language, but in my opinion, they are major fools when they talk like this. But maybe they don't know what they say. I don't know. They say, oh, since I became religious, every week problems. Tore my car 3 times. I got fired. through 6 months I cannot find a job, my parents are angry at me, my cousin don't want to come to my birthday party, all these stupid complaints. These people don't know how lucky they are. Why? 30 years of sins, Chilulei Shabbat. 30 years of Chilulei Shabbat. 30 years. And what do you want? You keep 2 weeks Shabbat, you already want everything to be forgotten? Come on, man. 30 years you murder people every day. One day you come to the judge and say, I regret. I killed 50,000 people I know. I really feel bad about it. I wish I had the brain to think not to murder people. But I'm not going to murder anymore. Please leave me alone. What judge will buy your nonsense? For your chutzpah, they'll double your punishment. It's no problem. We appreciate you came to confess. We appreciate you won't murder again. We appreciate it. But let's pay you for what you deserve. And what the criminals, when they come out of jail, what's the first thing they say? I paid my obligation to society. Now leave me alone. Why? Now they feel great. Once I got punished and I finished my punishment, that helps them to clear their conscience. Which not always is the same thing, because in Shamayim it still can be 100% guilty. Right? So now here is the conclusion so far. Since that has karet, if a person died without making tshuva, that's it, that's his end. And there's no share to the world to come. Hashem send him to a not good place until one day the sins are erased, and then he decides what to do with him. But if he made tshuva, which means he regrets that he did it, he says vidui every day, he never repeats the sin, he's ashamed of what he did, Yom Kippur come, 1 year, 2 years, 5, 10, 20 years, every Yom Kippur helps to erase a little more, it's not enough. Only suffering concludes the repentance. Suffering. Now what's suffering? Suffering means delay in having children. Doctor's appointment, root canals, teeth problem, stomach problem, gas in the stomach all the time, suffering, mental problems, stress, anxiety attack, losing lots of money, your children drinking your blood for breakfast. There's a lot of way to suffer today. Plenty of way. Somebody put an article about you in a newspaper, the whole world is laughing at you. You got arrested for something stupid. So many ways to suffer, and we all suffer. We all suffer. No one can come and say, I had one day in my life without having some suffering. Suffering can be traffic. Even Donald Trump suffered. If he's running to an important $1 million meeting, or a billion, I should say, million is nothing anymore. He has a $1 billion project now, and he's meeting an important banker, and now he's stuck in traffic. With all his billions, he cannot fly. By the time they send him an helicopter in a LIE, it won't help that much. So that hour that he was killing himself, knowing I'm losing this deal, that's suffering. Suffering can be sick in bed 3 or 4 days. Suffering can be a surgery. Suffering wins if his wife cheated on him and he had to go through a divorce and give her, I don't know, $200 million as a prize for her cheating. You know? There could be many, many different ways of suffering. And everyone, enough with question. And everything that the person is suffer is a part of the erasing the karet sins. Erasing the karet sins only through suffering. So therefore, if a person made tshuva, the best thing can happen to him is to go through this suffering period. However, how to suffer, it's not a decree. I'll explain what I mean. Hashem decided that a person this year will get 300 kilo of suffering. 300 kilo, 3,000 kilo, 500,000 kilo of suffering. 10 tons of suffering, 100 tons of suffering, depend on how many Chilulei Shabbat, depend on how much Chametz he ate, depend on how many sins he made. The sins have weight. Now he evaluates how much suffering this person has to receive. So Hashem decided that this person will get this year X amount of suffering. But if this person is a part of his tshuva, is doing things that he needs a lot of devotion and lots of effort. For instance, he pick up boxes and go give food to the poor person every Thursday night. He carry on his shoulder and he does chesed and go from one place to another, and nobody forced him to. You can become Shomer Shabbat, you can do mitzvot, but who told you that you have to be Tomchei Shabbos and run to houses and go three steps up, or all kinds of things, or wash dead bodies? When he bring mitzvot that are very painful, that he needs a lot of efforts to do this mitzvot, Hashem takes away from his suffering. The best way to take away from your suffering is learning Torah. Because learning Torah, you make your brain work very hard. You put lots of efforts in thinking. The harder you learn, the more hours you learn, the more of your suffering are being erased. One other way to erase a lot of the sins is to wake up early in the morning and go to shul. If you get up to the good minyan in an early hour, that means you sacrifice from your energy, from your time. You could be in bed another hour or two, but you give it up to come to shul early, to the first or second minyan, whatever, in a normal early hour. Then Hashem takes away from your suffering. If you do not come, you get the suffering anyway. So you might as well use the suffering to a positive mitzvot. Not for, God forbid, suffering and doctors and surgeries. No questions, please. And suffering and all these things. Let's move on. Then the Torah continue. The Rambam continue here. There are sins. This is the last category and the worst, that even suffering does not erase. Even suffering cannot erase. What is it? What is it? Only the day of death, the execution or the accident or falling from a building or burning in a plane or crashing in a plane, or somebody shot him or stabbed him, or he got hit by a car, and many other ways to die, unfortunately. The day of the death erased that sin. Which sin I'm talking about? Chilul Hashem. Chilul Hashem. What's Chilul Hashem? Hashem is holy. Mechalel come from the word chol. Kodesh and chol. Taking Shabbat and make it a weekday, that's disrespecting God. Spitting in his face, if we can say such a thing. He gave you a covenant, a holy day, and what do you do? You became Chris or Mustafa or Elliot on Shabbat. What you became? A goy. Go to McDonald's, eat as usual, carry your money, your cell phone, driving a car. Like a goy, 100%. Hashem gave you the greatest gift impossible. What do you do in this day? Becoming Ahmed, becoming Chris. That's big, big, big disappointment. Big, big, big ungratefulness. Is mamash horrible behaving. This is violating the rules. However, the time that a person take the name of Hashem and make it not important, not holy, how a person does it, stealing with a yarmulke, they caught him now. That's the religion? The religion taught you to be a thief? Right away, he lowered the value of the Torah and God. His behaving as a representative of God made the goyim make fun at God and the Torah. Because the goyim say, oh, that's the face of the Jews. This is the Jews. That's what they do. That's what they do on Shabbat. That's what they do in business. That's what they do in marriage. That's what they do in raising children, etc., etc. That's called Chilul Hashem. Chilul Hashem can be cutting people on the highway. Double parking and blocking the area, and someone is honking 20 minutes, and then you come with your yarmulke, and he cursed all the Jews now in the world. You understand? Chilul Hashem, it's better not to do it. You know what you're telling me? What's better, to murder with a mask on or without a mask on? Of course, if you murder with a mask, the chance to get caught is much lower, right? But what's the right answer? It's better not to murder.
Yeah, but everybody...
It's illegitimate answer to tell you, yeah, murder with a mask. You understand? Everybody understand. If you already did it, do it with a mask. but a speaker, a preacher, a teacher, a rabbi, a doctor cannot give his patients or his students answers that will hint to them that it's fine, you can do it. You understand? We're almost done for today. We're almost done. Five more minutes patience, then you can ask me all your questions. So, the time of death is basically erasing that sin of Chilul Hashem. There's one more way to correct it in your lifetime before to die. Before. Making Kiddush Hashem, which is the opposite thing. I made a lot of Chilul Hashem. For instance, right now I have 300 tons of Chilul Hashem in my file. I use weight for you to understand what we're talking here about. Because every Chilul Hashem, Hashem evaluates how much it's worth. It's negative right now. That goes to your file. How do you balance it? Since Chilul Hashem is the worst sin, Kiddush Hashem is the greatest achievement. So now if you will do a lot of Kiddush Hashem, that shows that this Chilul Hashem is not you anymore. You're the opposite now. You understand? You used to be a doctor that make abortions, murdering babies every day. One day you found out that you know better than a Nazi. You're murdering kids every day. You stopped it. You regret it. You're ashamed that you did it. You eat your heart that you did it. For $1 billion, you'll never do it again. But it's not enough. Everybody saw, look at that Jew. He did so many things of them. What's the way to correct it? To become an activist against it. To write articles, to interview, to write letters, to convince other doctors. That automatically helps you in your serious problem of murdering so many babies. Now time for questions. Let's start.
What if you do it because, is there a difference if you do it because you're scared for the punishment or if you want to do it?
There's a difference. Both of them is good. If a person doesn't want to become righteous because that's the truth, because he loves God, let him do it because he's afraid of the punishment. Of course, it's better than to stay wicked, right? So, and when you drive on a highway, when the police is putting a trap to catch you and to give you a $300 fine, when you pass the test, you didn't speed, the police doesn't care that you didn't speed because you appreciate the law, that it's the right law and you're afraid of people's life, or you only drive slow because you're afraid of the $300 penalty. Mm-hmm. Bottom line, you're innocent, right? But in Shamayim it's not like that, because Hashem gives a much greater reward to a person who does the mitzvot and does not commit the sins, because that's the word of God. Because I don't want to be ungrateful. I cherish what He gave me. I'm not going to take the oxygen and the money and the wisdom that He gave me to use it against Him. That's called a sinner. I don't want to do it. Not because of the punishment. Even if you come and tell me, don't worry, you are clean, you'll never get punished. Only reward. If you don't do the right mitzvah, you don't get the reward, but there's no punishment for you. Will I still keep everything? If yes, that means I'm in a very high level of a person who made repentance. But if I only do it because I'm afraid of the punishment, the Gemara say it's not a superior tshuva. And I say, today, 2,000 years after the Gemara was written, 1,600 years after the Talmud was concluded, I wish that all the Jews in the world will become religious from fear, not even one from love. Everyone from fear, than what we have today. That few percentage doing it from love, another few percentage do it for fear, and almost 80% do it not doing it at all. What's better? You understand? Let them all do it with fear that everyone finally do the right thing. Better than nothing. Right now what we have, you have few percent that do it from love. Very few, 2%, 3%, who knows, Hashem knows. Very, very minor percentage. Most of the religious people are afraid to lose their share to the world to come. They're afraid to lose their parnasa. They're afraid to get cancer. It's an epidemic. Every other person in the street has cancer today. I just spoke over there in the shul. One young person, in my opinion, he wasn't even 30. He comes downstairs 5 minutes before the lecture was over. Actually, he said that he was waiting for me 2 hours. Oh, now I got it. He came upstairs, and Chaim Tshuva sent him down to speak to me. Why? That I will give him a bracha that maybe he will get cured. Not even 30 years old. He said, I waited 2 hours until you finish your lecture because he told me that I should ask from your bracha. Why? You make a lot of people religious. Maybe thanks to you, Hashem will have mercy on me. So what do you have? Cancer. 30 years old. Every day. I show you just today. Today, at 3 years old, tumor in the head. I don't even know the results of the surgery. Tumor in the head, 3 years old girl. She walked to my friend, his wife, she's a doctor. They brought the girl for something minor. And the doctor, she realized that she walked crooked. She's off balance. Right away, she sent them to MRI. The results came after a few days. Tumor in her head. Growth. Today, a very complicated surgery by the best doctor in the world. That's how complicated it is. So my friend told me that his wife said that doctor, his hand is like a robot. Robot. You know robot? Robot is like computer. Computer always precise. Hey, a person, hands can shake, can move by mistake, right? Robot is robot. So this doctor, there's two doctors that can do this surgery. One here in New York and one in India.
Are they religious?
What? I don't know, I didn't go into details. No, I don't have to be religious. It can be the biggest rasha in the world, and it's a good doctor. It doesn't, yeah.
Do you make yourself suffer?
No. No, it's a good question, good. Christians hold that you make yourself suffer. So the priests don't get married, and they have all kinds of things that they believe in sigufim. Somehow, it entered Judaism to some parts of Judaism. That some Jews believe that if you torture yourself, they will help you to erase your sins. Not everyone agrees with this kind of thinking. This philosophy, for sure, for this generation doesn't apply, for sure. Because in this generation, even to fast is not good. So, you know, many people want to erase their sin, they fast. They fast. Now, if you're a person that do nothing, you can fast as much as you want. Anyway, you're not benefiting the world. You're not a help to the world. You live with your life, you're not benefiting anyone. But if you're a person who sits and learns Torah, now because you fast, you learn 1 hour less. It's hard for you to learn until 7 in the evening straight, like you do every day. Because you're fasting, thirsty, you're dizzy, your stomach bothers you. So you're at 5 o'clock, you fall asleep. The 2 hours you missed learning Torah is like a million days of fast. Learning Torah, there's no end to your reward and to the importance of what you do. What was the point of fasting and losing Torah? Even losing in the value of Torah, which means in the level of learning. You learn the same 10 hours, but with less concentration because you're not eating today. Not only you did not gain by fasting, you lost a lot. It's called Yatzah Scharo Be'efsedo. Or if you work for your boss, Jew or a goy is your boss. Because you are fasting today, you're not working as good. If you're a teacher, you teach the kids because you're fasting, it's hard for you. So you're not teaching as good as always. You're not only not helping yourself by fasting, you become a thief because you're stealing from your employer. Because you gave him less production than every day. And that's because of your private manners, nothing to do with your boss. Your boss doesn't have to lose money because you decided to rest today and fast. You understand? So if you're independent and you're staying in bed anyway, and anyway you do nothing today, and you didn't learn Torah anyway, no, it's good, you fast. But if you do something productive, better not to fast. Yes?
I have a question because I've been having back problems for a long time. And you're saying about suffering, and for me it's suffering because when I sit down, even when I try to learn, I can't. Like, you can see every second I'm moving.
Right.
Now, what would you say, why would you say that I would have that? Because I was wondering.
First of all, you should know that it's all in your head. And I'll tell you how you cure yourself. Give it 3 months, you see that it's work. From now on, every time you're alone, don't do it in front of people because they think you're crazy. But when you're by yourself, whether you take a shower or you're alone or you're in a room alone or before you go to sleep, have a conversation with your brain. It's not a joke. I'm 100% serious. Talk to your brain and tell your brain like this, because the brain reacts based on the information that he receives. Now, sometimes the information is a wrong information and the brain reacts in a false alarm. which means sometimes the alarm goes on for no reason. Static, electric, airplane went by, something, noise, all of a sudden the alarm goes on. Why? Nobody touched the car. It's called false alarm. All you have to do is convince your brain that you don't have any physical problem. You tell your brain, why are you sending me pain to my back? I don't have any problem. All my discs are lined, the discs. I don't have any problem. I didn't carry anything heavy. There's no reason for me to have pain. And after 2-3 months, you see that the brain will get the point and he will stop sending you pain through the nerve system into that place.
The thing is,
yes, that's how it is. I did it. I was in Israeli army. I had an MRI. They told me all my discs are left, right, one in the left, one in the right. They suggested I'll do a surgery. I started to talk to my brain. I calmed him down. Once in a while, he still make problems. I couldn't get up from the chair. Much worse than you. I couldn't write. If I sit, let's say I eat something for 10 minutes, let's say I cannot get up from the chair. And I have a friend, he was crawling in a house, crawling. Couldn't even stand. And he taught somebody that taught me, and I teach you, you understand? And now many people that have back pain. But every second that you have pain, if you have in mind, thank you God that you're sending me this pain, please use it to erase my sins, all the Yisurei Karet, is 100% profit. You got it? Okay, no? Yeah.
So,
every time you raise your hand, I begin to shake. Yalla, let's
you
go.
Get a lot of pressure.
Yeah, no, no. I mean, look.
If you judge somebody favorably, right? In that type of story, and if, let's just say that you would say, you know what? Forget about the one bad thing that this person did. I'm going to just remember all the good things. Is it possible that's the way that Hashem will judge us, that he'll forget about something?
Not possible. That's how it works. Kol ha-ma'avir al midotav, ma'avirim lo kol psha'av. Every person who give up, who is humbled, forgive. Whatever he does to others, that's what Hashem does to him. Measure for measure. Mida keneged mida. You judging everyone negative, you are strict, you don't have, your eyes narrow, you not a pleasant person, you always see the negative, Hashem is the same thing with you. But you say, this person, I know him, this is not what he meant, I'm sure he had reasons, believe me, if you talk to him, you'll see that it's not what you think. Okay, so as human being, we can also make that mistake. Thinking positive like this, it's called Ma'avir al Midotav. It's a sign that Hashem is doing the same thing with him. But you have to know one thing. What the Torah says, that you have to give the benefits of the doubt to every person. Don't make no mistake. It's not what you think. It depends on the chazakah of that person. Chazakah means status. The status, the certainty of that person. For instance, if a person well known is smoking cigarettes on Shabbat, talking on the phone in the street and driving his car, if you see him now in the middle of Shabbat running with his kid, holding his kid and running into the car and getting in and driving somewhere, you may think, no, he's taking the kid to the hospital. Why would he carry his daughter? No, maybe she fell asleep. I don't have to give him the benefits of the doubt. For me, he's 100% sinning right now. When do I have to give him the benefits of the doubt? When his certainty is kosher, for instance, I know he's a person that keeps Shabbat. And now I saw him in my own eyes smoking a cigarette. How can I give him the benefits of the doubt for smoking a cigarette? Maybe driving a car, he goes to the hospital. It could be. But smoking a cigarette? Yes, how do you know? Maybe an Arab guy kidnapped his... So the camera just shot on us, but we didn't miss anything. So we continue from where I stopped. So if I see a person smoking a cigarette on Shabbat, and I know it's a Shomer Shabbos, maybe an Arab guy kidnapped his son and told him, the only way you get your son back if you walk all day and smoke. That's pikuach nefesh. He's doing mitzvah now, that's smoking a cigarette, because he's saving the life of his son. So not only is not a sin, it's pikuach nefesh. I have to give him the benefits of the doubt, because I know him for 10 years, he's keeping Shabbat. He's not going to walk like this and smoke. You understand? Or if a person is well known as a kosher person that eats kosher, and one time I saw him coming out of McDonald's, what do I have to say? Probably needed the bathroom badly, and he couldn't wait another minute. I don't say, I saw him coming out of McDonald's because he was eating cheeseburger. No. You understand the point? But if he's a person that eats anyway in McDonald's every week, what am I going to play a fool? Oh, you know why he came out of McDonald's? Because he needed the bathroom. No. I have to say he went to McDonald's to eat pork. Because that's what he does every week. Everybody, he is what he's doing. You understand? If a person has a kosher status, you judge him favorably. But if he has a negative status, you don't give him any benefits of the doubt. You got the point? So you don't judge everyone lekaf zchut. Only those who deserve to be judged lekaf zchut. For instance, if he's a thief, he's already convicted in a Beis Din a few times, and we all here in a house, and $100 is missing for someone's coat. When the police come, what do we say to the police? This guy is the thief, even though we have no proof. The police say, how do you know? He says, he's the only one who has the status of a thief. Everybody else has a kosher status here. Start with him. That's how it goes. Hi, what about the benefits of the doubt? Benefits of the doubt to someone who earned it, not someone who steals every day. You understand? That's how the law is. Okay, that's enough for today. The questions will never end. We will see you, Bezrat Hashem, next week.